Hey everyone, Steve from Backcountry Gallery here, coming to you from my office because I want to do a follow-up on that 600PF and I have a lot of stuff to show you in Lightroom. I figured it'd be easier to do it here from the office. I do apologize, this is not going to be the prettiest video you ever see from me, but I think you're going to like the information because in this video, we're going to follow up that first initial review that I did and I made a lot of promises in there as far as other things we're going to look at once I get the production copy. Well, I have the production copy and I'm going to make good on my promises. So in this video, we're going to look at things like AF speed, background rendering, focus breathing, gimbal balance, and a foot that I found that works perfectly fine with this that's actually used on some other lenses, but it works really well with this lens and it balances perfectly on a gimbal, even with a Z9. We're going to look at sharpness, of course, and I have some VR tests for you as well. So lots of stuff in this video. So let's go ahead and just dive right in. So let's start with some speed tests. We have minimum focus distance to infinity, all with a Z9. Now, if you watched my first look review for this lens, you'll know that the time was 0.45 with my kind of impromptu AF speed test down in Florida. I was curious if the production lens would match those numbers or not, so I used my own normal testing setup out here in my backyard and actually came up with a better number. Now, I checked this like three different times and 0.417 seconds was the number. So it's actually slightly faster than the pre-production model was and just on the heels of the 600TC. Now, if you're wondering how it compares to other lenses, I have you covered there too. You can take a look at this list if you like. Now, one quick thing that I do want to kind of take a sidetrack here. People ask all the time, why minimum focus distance to infinity? Why not like some arbitrary distance, like 20 meters to infinity or something like that? The reason is simple. I'm not so concerned about how fast the lens can focus once it's actually on a subject, which that other test, the preset focus distance would kind of give us an indicator of that. Because pretty much every lens, no matter how slow it focuses, is going to be able to stick with pretty much any subject if it has a good AF lock. Where we get in trouble is those initial pickups, those initial lock-ons, and if the lens starts hunting. That's where you see a really big difference between something that focuses fast and something that focuses slower. It's not that you can't use a slower focusing lens for action, you absolutely can, but you do have to kind of help the lens to be in the right place from a focal plane sort of perspective. So I'm gonna actually do a video on this, so make sure you subscribe. I'm gonna talk about this in a lot more detail, but that's why I'm doing the minimum focus distance to infinity thing, because I'm more concerned about how long it takes the lens to hunt back and forth if you miss the target or the target gets dropped by the AF system and those initial pickups. That's where the speed tests for minimum focus distance to infinity really matter. So let's move on. Next, let's talk about focus breathing. So before we go into the charts and comparisons, let's talk about what that is. Focus breathing is basically the phenomenon where as you get closer to your subject, as you get towards a lens's minimum focus distance, the focal length of the lens actually will change a little bit. So maybe you have a 600 normally, but as you get to that minimum focus distance, you end up more like 580. It has to do with the internal focusing mechanism of the lens. It actually changes the focal length a little tiny bit sometimes. Sometimes it's a lot, depends on the lens, but most lenses it's pretty minimal, it's not a big deal. But I was curious if this lens experienced any focus breathing, so I thought, let's compare it to the 600TC. So I went down with my little test chart, and this is the crop of that test chart that I get at about minimum focus distance with the 600TC. Now the 600PF has roughly the same minimum focus distance, so they're both really, really close here for that for those particular lenses. So I had a little bit of a surprise here. Check it out. Here's a 600TC. Here's the 600PF. 600TC, 600PF. The 600PF is actually experiencing less focus breathing at minimum focus distance than the 600TC. I thought that was very interesting there. I did not expect to see that, but here it is right there, back and forth. I did this test a couple of times, and I made sure that the focal plane of the camera was the exact same distance from the target for each one of these tests, and this is kind of how it ended up. So it looks like, although neither of them are really suffering much from any kind of focus breathing problem, it's certainly not a big deal either way, the 600PF does have a little tiny bit of an edge here over the 600TC. Thought that was interesting. What about the 180 to 600? A lot of people are debating between the 180 to 600 and the 600PF since they're both 600 at 6.3, and of course the zoom is much less expensive. However, as you can see, the zoom is giving us a wider shot, meaning it has a little more focus breathing than the 600 PF, and it has more focused breathing than the 600 TC as well. So, and again, it's not as expensive, so you would expect that. And zooms tend to have a little bit more focused breathing than primes. And just so you don't freak out about any of this, it's very common for lenses to have a little bit of focused breathing. Pretty much all modern lenses have it to some degree, so no freakouts there. But anyhow, just thought you'd be interested in that. Next, let's talk about VR and how well it works with this lens. Now, before we do this though, I have to kind of give you a few caveats. Keep in mind that I did this test in the comfort of my basement. It's a finished basement, it's very nice and warm. And I had a nice little test chart there. I'm standing comfortably, pretty much the exact opposite of the conditions we'd see in the outdoors. So you have to keep some of that in mind here. Plus, also keep in mind that VR is kind of a weird thing when it comes to individuals, because sometimes we're really steady and other times maybe it's been a long day and we're a little fatigued and we're not as steady as we were before. So keep in mind that this is kind of just a general bit of information here, and that in the real world, when we're out there in the snow and the wind and the rain and we're kind of leaning in a weird position from our, you know, trying to get the animal framed up, maybe these numbers aren't going to hold quite so well. So with all that in mind, let's take a look at what we have here. Now, basically what I did for these VR tests is I had my test chart up and I just handheld the lens and I shifted shutter speed, and then I went through and I figured out the percentage of sharp photos, and I'd basically take like a 1 to 2 second burst of each one of these different shutter speeds with VR enabled or disabled or on sport, normal, whatever, you'll see. So anyhow, so let's start with VR off. I'm a little embarrassed here to show you this because these are not very impressive numbers, but you know, we have to have transparency, right? So here we go. So as you can see, at 1/15th, 1/30th, 1/60th, and 1/25th, I'm pretty pathetic. I'm not getting anything that I consider acceptably sharp. 1/250th isn't much better at 12%. That's pretty low. 1/500th, 18%, not great. 1/1000th, I'm really hitting my stride, getting 90% of them, so I'm happy with that. So probably for me to shut off VR, I probably need to be 800/1000th of a second to be safe. So let's take a look at VR normal. Things get much, much better for me here. As you can see, at 1/1000th, I'm getting 100%. I'm getting 96% at 500 and 250. 1/25th is 80%, which is still great. I mean, basically 1/25th with it off, I'm getting zero. Here, I'm still getting 79% of them, or I'm sorry, 80% of them at 1/25th, pretty good. At 1/60th, I'm getting 79%. That is fantastic. 1/30th of a second, I'm getting 41% of my photos sharp. And 1/15th of a second, though, that's where things really drop off. I'm down to 8%. But still, this is pretty good. But again, keep in mind, I'm in a very comfortable position. I'm hand-holding, I'm standing up hand-holding, which I very seldom do. I'm usually on my knees or crawling around or something. So again, keep in mind that this might not really translate as well as it seems like it might to the real world. What about sport? Let's take a look. With sport, the numbers go down a little bit. So 1/500th, it's 94 instead of 96. 250th, it's 94 instead of 96. Then 1/25th, we're seeing a bigger difference, 65% versus 80. At 60th of a second, we're down to 62 versus 79. And then 30th of a second, we're just a few points off there. That one didn't have as big a discrepancy. But again, keep in mind, there's a lot of variables here. Maybe I was a little steadier in sport mode for that particular round than I had been for everything else. Who knows? And then at 1/15th, it's down to just 4%. So the takeaway here is that VR in this lens is actually really good. I wasn't so sure about it with the pre-production model because, again, I was outdoors. I was in very awkward positions. And my thought was that it was pretty typical. That wasn't fantastic, but it was pretty, you know, it was average. But looking at these numbers, it seems like maybe it's okay. Now, the other thing here, there's a couple of takeaways from this. And one of those is that I have found and have been finding that it sometimes seems like VR normal is a little more effective than VR sport. The problem is VR normal kind of bounces around in the viewfinder. The viewfinder image moves around quite a bit. And that's because the VR group is recentering between shots. So sometimes that's a little disorienting. So most of the time, even though my numbers are a little better with VR normal, I'll leave it in VR sport unless I'm kind of dipping into really low shutter speed, say under 1/25th of a second, which is really a low shutter speed when you're talking about 600 millimeter. Now, the other thing here I wanted to mention really quick is I want to give you the advice that I've given this advice quite a bit. You've probably heard this before, but one of the things that I do when I am shooting at slower shutter speeds is that I take longer bursts. So I'll have my frame rate set as fast as it'll go, and I'll just lay on the shutter, but I will take a longer series of shots than I will at faster shutter speeds. And the reason for that is I'm just playing these percentage numbers you see here on the screen. So what I'm doing is, if I know I'm getting, say, 10% of my photo sharp, that's pretty low. So I know only 1 in 10 photos is going to be sharp. So maybe I shoot 20 or 30 photos when the animal's looking at me. I just lay on that trigger so that I can get those sharp images. So I know I'm going to have to sort through a bunch of them when I get home, but at least I know I'm going to have a couple of sharp ones in there. So again, anytime I'm shooting at slower shutter speeds, I highly recommend, anytime you're doing it, I highly recommend those longer bursts. Save the shorter bursts for when you're, you know, at these faster shutter speeds that work pretty well with VR. So let's move on. Another question I've been getting is, what kind of foot can I put on here that's, you know, has those Arca-Swiss dovetails? And as it turns out, the Kirk LP70, I've been using this one for my 100 to 400, 70 to 200, and 400 4.5. So this foot works perfectly on the 600PF. I'll show you here. It just attaches, no problem at all. Hopefully you can see that. Snaps right in, tighten it down. There we go. All set to go. I found that it balanced just fine on the gimbal head. As you can see here, no problems with balance. I did have to push it forward a little bit, and there is a small gap there, but nothing that I'm too concerned about. But if you're kind of impatient and you already have a third party foot for one of those other three lenses, again, the 70 to 200, 400 4.5, or 100 to 400, if you have a third party foot for those, chances are it's gonna work just fine on the 600PF. And this, again, balanced even with the Z9, the heavy Z9 attached to it. So that's pretty impressive. Next, let's talk about background rendering, because that's sometimes an Achilles heel for a PF lens. So let's see how it compares to other lenses that we're maybe somewhat familiar with. So we're going to start this with the 600PF versus the 600TC. So let's take a look at these. And here is the 600 6.3. Here's a 600TC wide open at f4. A lot of times people say, why do you get the 600TC when it's almost $11,000 more? This is some of that reason right here. You can see the background is so much smoother. The subject stands out better. It's just a nicer shot to look at there. So that's a big part of it. So obviously you can see the difference between 6.3 and 4. Matter of fact, let's compare them side by side. That is night and day difference, really it is. There's a big difference between those two shots. So let's compare the backgrounds with the 600PF to the 600TC at f6.3. And here you go. On the left, once again, we have the 600PF, and on the right, we have the 600TC. And at first glance, they're kind of close, but if you really look at it, the 600TC definitely seems to have an edge. I'm not an optical engineer, but looking at this, it just seems like the transitions are smoother, the blurry transitions from one to the other are smoother, and they spread out a little bit nicer than what we see here. They don't have as much of an edge to them, which is what you want for your background. You want a smoother, softer looking background most of the time because you don't want the eye going to it. And if we look at these, let's look at them instead of side by side, let's kind of bounce between them. So I'll turn that off. So let's just kind of bounce between these, and you can really see it when you're jumping between them. Look especially down here in this green area. And as it goes back and forth, you can really see a difference. And here's the 600PF, here's the 600TC. That whole background just looks a little bit nicer with the 600TC. And again, though, it is about $11,000 more than the 600PF. So, you know, maybe we expect a little bit more from a lens like that. So I think this is fine. Next, let's compare it to the 180 to 600, the zoom lens, versus the 600PF. Now, in this case, I think it's pretty close, but I think the PF, the prime, definitely has an edge. Again, looking at the background, I'm looking at the transitions, I'm looking at how busy it feels, how disturbed it feels, and just looking at it, it seems to me that the 600PF does look a little bit nicer. And if we kind of come out of compare mode here and just look at them one right after the other, it's easier to see, I think. So here's the 600PF, and here's the 180 to 600. And going back and forth, again, they're very, very close, but I still think the rendering is a little bit nicer. I'm definitely gonna give the edge to the 600PF on this one. And again, though, it is a much more expensive lens, so you would expect that it would have some advantages over the less expensive zoom lens. Although the zoom does really hold up well here in this comparison. Next, let's take a look at the 600 PF versus the 500 PF from the same distance. And obviously we have a noticeably different size here for our tripod head because we're using 500 millimeter instead of 600 millimeter, but the background also suffers here too. And obviously if I got closer with the 500 PF, the background would probably look a lot more like what we see here with the 600 PF, but when you're doing wildlife, a lot of times we don't have that option. We get as close as we can get and that's all we can do. And a lot of times we still have to crop. So I'm looking at this as if this is an animal. I can't get any closer and I have this lens, the 600 PF, or I have the 500 PF, and I'm looking at the two side by side here. And it's obvious that there's a pretty significant difference here in the way that background renders. And it's basically because of that difference in focal length. The third of a stop difference isn't enough to make up for that 100 millimeters of focal length when it comes to that background rendering there. And once again, let's take a look at these one after the other as they're filling the screen. So here we have the 600 PF and here's the 500 PF. And again, looking at the background, it's definitely less busy with the 600 PF. So to me, that lens really does have quite an edge in this case over the 500 PF. Next, let's take a look at the 400 4.5 with a 1.4 teleconverter, which brings it to 560 millimeter. I had a lot of people asking me about this particular combo in the comments when I did that first look review. So I want to make sure I've included it here. And we have some sharpness tests here too coming up. So anyhow, looking back and forth here between the two of them, you can see that it definitely seems that the 600 PF is rendering that background more pleasantly than the 400 with the teleconverter. They're not bad. Neither one of them are bad. I think that's both very usable, but it definitely looks a little nicer with the 600 6.3, the 600 PF there. And once again, let's jump between them. Looking at the more full screen here, I think it's a little bit easier sometimes to jump between them looking at them like this. And you can see the 400 4.5, it's not bad, but the 600 PF is just a little bit nicer. The background looks just a little bit better to me. Now, I also realize some people are cross-shopping brands as they watch this channel. So I wanted to include the Sony 200 to 600 here. And if you look at the two of them, we do see some more focus breathing with the Sony 200 to 600. It's a little bit lower in the frame. If you notice, I do have more of this in here, so it's not quite as drastic as it might look right here. But if you're just looking at the backgrounds here, again, same exact distance we had throughout all of these shots. I did not change the distance here. And you can see the background rendering here does look better with the 600 PF. Once again, that 600 PF just about the only thing I've seen that's really topping it is the 600 TC. The background still looks great here. So let's take a look once again. We'll kind of flip between them in full screen mode. Let me do that. So bouncing back and forth between them, you can see again, I just like the rendering of the 600 PF better than the Sony in this case. And again, I'm not surprised. Again, we're looking at a prime versus a much less expensive zoom. So I think this is kind of the thing you can expect here. Finally, just for fun, I thought I would compare the 600 millimeter lenses with a TC on them. I just did the 600 PF here and the 600 TC with the TC engaged, just to kind of show you the difference here in case you're curious what that extra $11,000 buys you. And you can see it's, you know, a significant difference here. In fact, if we go out of comparison mode here and just flip between them, you can see it's very noticeable. It's not that the 600 PF is bad. It's kind of holding its own a little bit. That background isn't terrible. But once you compare it to what you're seeing with the 600 TC, that 600 TC just kind of wipes it out. But I just thought it'd be fun to kind of compare and contrast those two a little bit there. Before we get to the sharpness tests, just a quick note for all the Z8 and Z9 shooters out there. Those cameras are loaded with controls and options, and if you want to learn the best settings and configurations for wildlife work, you'll want to check out my wildlife photography setup guide for the Z8 and Z9. Not only will it help you choose the best settings, it'll talk about how to use those settings in the field to really crank up your keeper rate. Grab your copy today and join the thousands who already use the techniques in the book to fill their memory cards with wall hangers each time they're out. Finally, let's talk sharpness. I know this is what everybody's been waiting for. You want to see how this compares to other lenses. I have a bunch of them to show you here, but we're going to start off against the big gun. We're going to start off against the 600 TC wide open at F4 versus this wide open at F6.3. So let's zoom in and see what we have. Looking at these side by side, they are neck and neck. If you're asking me right there for sharpness, I'm not seeing much of a difference. I'm going up here and once again, these look like they are neck and neck. This is 200%, by the way. This isn't 100%. I'm really digging in here. And I'm scrolling around. And again, I'm looking at it. Again, the 600 PF is over here. And the 600 TC is over here. And to me, These are looking pretty much identical. I'm not seeing any significant difference in sharpness at all. And that's kind of what I was experiencing when I was looking at the photos from this lens as I was editing them for that first look review. It seemed like I was seeing that same kind of sharpness that I get from the 600TC. That's one of the things they were saying about this lens, is that it is very, very sharp, has good side-to-side sharpness, and definitely you can see it here. In some cases, I think the 600TC might have a very slight edge, right? I mean, you'd have to almost get to 300-400% to see it. This is just insane, guys. This looks fantastic. So to me, this lens looks like it is just as sharp as the 600TC pretty much across the frame. Let's see how it compares to some other glass. Next, let's compare the 600PF to the 400 4.5 with a 1.4 teleconverter. Why? Because this has got to be the number one question people asked. Why get a 600PF versus the 400 with a teleconverter? The 400 with the teleconverter is more versatile from a focal length standpoint. You have two instead of one, and it's significantly cheaper to go that route. It's not cheap to go that route, but it's cheaper than getting the 600 6.3. However, I think you're about to find out why. We're gonna zoom in, and in the center, looking pretty good. Now, as I go up, again, keeping in mind that the 600PF is on the left here, you can see in this area here, this writing is definitely a little bit more crisp than this. This isn't bad. This is pretty darn close, but this is better. Now, as we get more towards the edges, let's go over here. You can see a big difference here in the lettering. It's just, you know, it's kind of night and day. We go down here, you can see it's definitely sharper with the 600 6.3, and that's not like it's right up against the edge. I could totally see having a bird's head here if you were shooting like a vertical great blue heron or something like that. Going over to this side, we're seeing kind of the same thing. Definitely sharper with the 600 6.3, and definitely softer over here. And if you take a look towards this edge, you can see all the little spindles here look real nice, and they're kind of blurring together over here. So it's not that the 400 4.5 of the TC is bad. I use that combination myself, and I've been very happy with the results. It's just that it's not as strong as you start getting kind of towards those edges, and those edges can be critical at times. So definitely the 600 6.3 has an edge over that lens in sharpness. Now let's compare the 600PF to just the 400PF without the teleconverter involved, just to kind of see how they compare. I think they're very, very close. We'll look here. That looks really good. We scroll up here, neck and neck once again. A little bit slightly different color balance there. They're both looking very good. Coming over here, neck and neck. It looks very, very close. Yeah, the 400 holds up pretty well. It looks like the 600, once again, is holding up at the extreme edge just a little better than the 400 4.5, but otherwise they look like they are competing head to head. Coming over here, once again, yeah, I'd say that these guys are very, very close. It looks like, again, as we get towards these edges, I think the 600PF has a very slight edge on the 400 4.5. without the teleconverter on it, you know, just bare lens to bare lens. So, but still the 400 4.5 holds up pretty well. I wouldn't be afraid to shoot either one of these. Next, let's take a look at the 600PF versus the 180-600 at 600mm. And I feel like you're already ahead of me with the results, but we'll look anyway. Zoom in the center, they're both looking pretty good. This is very, very close. If we go up just a little bit, you can see even the textures here look very, very similar. If we go into these little patches of gray up here and zoom in, we can see that the prime is starting to pull ahead just a little bit. It looks like there's a little better texture. It's a little more defined, slightly more acuity here, but it's very, very close in this range. Now, as we get towards the edges, I think this is where nobody's going to be surprised that the prime is outdoing the zoom. The lettering over here, it's okay. It's not great. The printing over here is nice and crisp and sharp, though. And as we get towards this edge and we look at this little spindly circle, you know, all of these little lines are very crisp and distinct, even all the way at the edge here, whereas with the zoom, they are really starting to fade out over here. They're really starting to, you're really starting to see the difference here. And going over to this other side, we can see same kind of thing, nice crisp lettering and printing over here. This side, it's not bad. It's okay. And as we get closer to the edges, we can see once again with our little spindle circles that we're definitely seeing more definition and more acuity with the 600PF. And I don't think this is a big shock. And I think, you know, it's interesting that it's so close, at least at this distance, considering the difference in price here. So anyhow, let's move on. For this round, we're going to look at the 600PF versus the 500PF, because the 600PF is, you know, technically its replacement. So let's zoom in here and start looking around. And these two are really close. This looks pretty good to me. Going up here from a sharpness standpoint, these are neck. This looks very, very close. I might give a very slight edge though over to the 600 PF. We'll go over to this side. Very, very close, but once again, it does seem like the 600 PF is a little bit more distinct and sharp with a little lettering here. So it looks like the 600 PF is definitely at least a slight improvement over the 500 PF. I thought they'd be a little bit closer, and they are very close. Now on this side, it's interesting. It looks like the 500 PF is slightly sharper over here, and they're more neck and neck than what we saw on the other side. Also keep in mind, and I suppose this is a good time to mention it, keep in mind that I only have one copy of each one of these lenses, and these are working lenses. You know, I'm out in the field with these, they've seen some use. So again, you know, we're looking at a sample size of one when we're comparing these, just kind of want to throw that out there. But either way, the 600 PF and the 500 PF seem like they are very, very close. I'm not seeing a huge difference. I doubt you could tell the difference between them if you were just looking at individual photos, unless maybe you got all the way over to the edge, because it does seem like the 600 PF is holding up better than the 500 PF. So either way though, still considering how old the 500 PF is, it does hold its own pretty well here. So looks pretty darn good. Now let's add some teleconverters. We'll start with the 600 PF versus the 600F4TC. And zoom in here, 600TC is on the right and the 600 PF is on the left. These look, once again, very, very close. 600TC has a little bit of an edge in this area. Not much, not much. Moving it over here, 600TC is still looking like I'm seeing a little bit more texture here. It's very, very close. It's amazingly close, really. And looking over here, the 600TC, yeah, this writing over here does look a little more crisp than what I see here with the 600 PF with the TC. So overall, yeah, let's take a look at this side. Sometimes you can see a difference in the sides there. Yeah, these are very, very close. In this case, I gotta say the 600 TC overall does seem to take its built-in TC slightly better than the 600 PF does, but these are incredibly close. This is another situation where unless you were looking at photos side by side and really zooming in there and really comparing, I don't know that you'd be able to tell which one was the 600 PF with a teleconverter and which one was the 600 TC with a teleconverter. They're both incredibly close here. But again, I do think that the 600 TC looks like it does have a very slight edge on the 600 PF with a TC, which, yeah, I would hope that it would, I guess, again, considering the price. Let's take a quick look at 800 and 840 millimeter. So keeping in mind, I'm looking at the 800 PF here. So that's 6.3 at 800 versus F9 at 800. So there's a big advantage to the 800 PF here just from that, you know, one-stop difference in light gathering ability. So let's zoom in. Very, very close. Surprisingly close. I am seeing a little bit, yeah, the 800 PF is starting to pull away here a little bit as we're coming up here. You can definitely see if you look at the textures here that the 800 PF is a little bit sharper. I don't think anyone's surprised by any of that. Looking over here, the 800 PF, what do you know, is sharper. So, and looking at some of the textures here. So yeah, look at the green texture here versus the one over here. And again, I would not expect the 600 PF with a teleconverter to be sharper than a prime without one. So this is not a big surprise, but just kind of shows you how it compares. The truth is the sharpness difference here is not drastic. So I think it's more of, do you want to shoot F9 or do you want to shoot F6.3? I think that's what it comes down to more than anything else between these two lenses, because the 600 PF does take that teleconverter pretty well. Next, let's take a look at the 600 PF versus the Sony 200 to 600 at 600 millimeter. So we'll zoom into the center and pretty darn close. Not seeing a huge difference here. Let's scroll up a little bit. I'm starting to see these little patches. I'm seeing more detail here with the prime. I don't think anyone's surprised about that. Go over towards the edges. Clearly at this point, the prime is pulling ahead. I don't think anyone, again, is surprised by that. Go over here, same thing. Nice crisp lettering over here. Not too bad over here on that side of the Sony, but it's not competing with the prime. So it's, you know, again, Sony's not bad, but if you look at the textures here in some of these patches, this green one's always a good one. And you can definitely see that there's a little bit more texture and pattern. You're getting more detail with the 600 PF, but again, it's more expensive lens. It's a prime. I don't think anyone's surprised with that at all. So in conclusion, I'm going to double down on what I've been saying. I think this is a baby 600 TC. We're looking at basically the same sharpness, the same AF speed, better in the focus breathing department, about the same VR. We're looking at the same kind of weather sealing, a lot of the same coatings and technologies gone into it optically. You know, and it's lighter weight, very easy to handle. The only major differences are the obvious ones. Obviously, it's 6.3 and not F4. That's what we're paying the big bucks for. Obviously, it does not have a built-in TC like the 600 TC. And of course, I have that little nitpick on the background rendering. I do think the 600 TC is rendering backgrounds better at F6.3 than the 600 PF is. But beyond that, I think it's a solid choice if you're looking for a relatively speaking affordable 600 millimeter versus the 600 TC. It is almost $11,000 less. Also, if you missed that first look video, make sure you check it out. These are two very separate videos with very different information in them. And to get kind of the whole picture of the 600 PF, you need to watch them both. And as always, I hope you'll subscribe, and thank you so much for watching. Have a great day.